Hello, Serge here from the teaching tee at Odessa National Golf School Day. And since I have the Rolfer Golfer with me here, Bruce Chafin, as you all know him, I'm going to bring up another question that's been on a blog recently. And when this one comes up,
it's a hot topic.
It fires up the typewriters or the computers. And that's, as you know, one of the number one principles of the Serge Peak Performance Swing is that wrist action is no wrist action. Good wrist action is no wrist action, and that there's no wrist cocking, hinging, flipping, flopping, whatever you want to call it at the top, or setting, as some people say. And most people really understand it, but sometimes it's still hard for them to chew on it and swallow that, especially when we start talking about release, that I'm not cocking my wrist. Mm-hmm. And that was the number one question that Dr. Armstrong answered for me one day when I called him, and it was the final piece of the puzzle that I knew that I was doing the right thing, because I said, when I hit the ball, I feel as like a snap down there. Am I breaking my wrist? Because I say no at the top, because if you're breaking your wrist at the top, you're either arching it or cupping it, and you're losing that flatness. And the Rolfer is going to define something a little bit different. But when I go this way, I'm not breaking my wrist. My arm is connected to the shoulder and ball and socket joint, and it's just rotating, but we're going to make sure it rotates the exact amount of degrees from toe up to toe up. Any more than that, if I go under, it's going to open the face and I start hitting balls to the right, slices or whatever, and if it goes over, I'm going to start hitting pulls and hooks. Yeah. And so we control the rotations by in the mid-toe up and in the mid-toe up. Now, this wrist cocking, give us your concept of it. Because I think it's nice. It's another, he's saying the same thing, but from a different viewpoint.
So what I try to explain to my clients is, in the wrist action that goes on in a golf swing, I try to tell them that the most powerful position, if you make a strong fist, your hand will be directly in line with your forearm. All your muscles will be tight, but your hand will be directly in line. It won't be left, right, up, down. It'll be strong and firm.
And relatively flat.
And relatively
flat. There's always a little bit of what looks like a curve there because of the fact that the wrist right here is skinnier than the forearm.
Right.
All right?
And so this is what a lot of people confuse as wrist cock. When you look at this and you start off with your wrist deviated because the weight of the club actually pulls the wrist down, and people think that they're cocking their wrist. In reality, if you make a strong fist and you put it right here to the three-quarter limited swing, they're calling that... That's what they're calling not lag, but they're calling it wrist cock, and that is actually no wrist movement at all. Yeah. So here's a little closer look again of this wrist. When you make a nice fist, everything is toned in here, and sideways you have this nice angle here, which is a perfect horizontal place for a backswing. And the one thing I want to show you is that at address, that wrist deviates a little bit. And in reality, when we come back to a swing, we're not creating lag. We're just going back to a strong, neutral position. And that doesn't change anywhere through the swing.
And that's why it's important to get the club equal to the hands fast and above it, right?
Yeah, and here's one of the things that happens a lot and with my clients that have problems in this area. If they play racquetball or tennis, they have a tendency to flip their wrist, because that's part of, you get jammed in a corner, you flip your wrist to play. And that's what people get confused in the golf swing. They'll come down through here and flip their wrist like this versus rotating. And that's another reason for some of tennis elbow or some problems with the tendons in this joint. But that's a prime example when Don talks about keeping a nice firm grip. If you're too loosey-goosey through here and holding a baby bird, it's really easy to let the weight of the club manipulate this in all sorts of directions. Don talks about getting nice and taut and an athletically ready position. And once you make that fist, you got that club, you start here, you're just holding that position in a nice wrist.
The arms are rotating, it's not flipping.
They're rotating through the swing, not flipping or chopping like wood or an axe through that swing.
Now, the other way I take it sometimes is, if I was standing here and all of a sudden Bruce said something, I didn't like what he was saying, I went boom like that, right? And I backhanded him. See, it's right there. Yeah. I'm not going to go like that and backhand him. I'm not going to go like that. I'm just boom, and that's it. And that means your wrist is basically flat. Now, what Bruce is just describing, Dr. Armstrong told me that he believes in what we call dynamic balance. And Dr. Armstrong, as you all know, he's my mentor for physiology since about 1983. Mm-hmm. He says dynamic balance is your muscles are at their optimum length to produce work. That means movement. And optimum length means that muscle groups work in harmony with each other or against each other.
Right.
Now, again, when you're at, as Bruce just said, you have basically, as I describe it, I'm sure he could tell you the exact names of the muscles, but I don't have the time
flexors
to learn
flexors and
that.
Extensors
right.
in
so,
balance.
All right, so we got an outside and an inside upper, and then we have an outside lower and an inside lower. All right, and when you go like to shake hands with somebody and you just do this, all of those muscles stay at the same length.
Right.
As soon as you do that, what's just happened? These two contracted and those two expanded. They just reversed it. One side or one group is always stretching and another is extending when you're changing a flex joint angle.
Mm-hmm.
So we want to swing where that doesn't change. And so in my mind, when I finally grip my golf club, and I stand here and I grip my golf club and I get going, both arms are at the exact, all these muscles are the same length. And in my mind, I can track that as I swing the club all the way through, I feel like those muscles never change.
Yeah.
So if the muscles never change, that means I maintain my angle.
Yeah, but go ahead and grab that club again. Now at address, go ahead and address the ball. You can see that his wrist, instead of being solid here, actually deviates a little bit to get the club down.
I might have a tweak of a stretch there, but as soon as I start picking that club up to get to the level of my hands, that toe up in the mitt, these muscles are all back to exactly the same length.
Right.
And from that point on, I'm keeping it all the way, except when I change direction, I get a little bit there, what we call the lag, I get a little pressure on
there. That's just the weight of the club. It's not an intentional.
I feel these a fraction more, but I don't feel them making any big change. So I really feel that once I start lifting this club up, and my goal is to get this club above my hands as fast as I can to point up to get it vertical where it's light, I can feel these muscles all the same. This basically, I got enough grip pressure that right there is almost rock hard.
Yeah.
All right? And so I'm up, down, all the way up into here, and then I finally let go. So I feel that from takeaway to finish in both these forearms, my muscle length, which is also tone, will never change.
Right.
All right? So from the raw for golfer and the surge here on the back tee, talking about maintaining the same grip all the way through and maintaining your number one domino angle, which is the forward wrist or left wrist for a right-handed golfer. That's us from us, and we'll be talking to y'all again soon.